I am absolutely delighted to welcome you here tonight. Please join me now in greeting one of the leading Czech pianists of our time, the gifted, dedicated, and brilliant Martin Kazik. Dr. John Templeton, President and Chair of the Templeton Foundation, Dr. Josephine Templeton, Monsignor Halík, distinguished trustees of the Templeton Foundation, Lord Griffiths of Forest Fac, Your Excellency Michael Zantovsky, Czech Ambassador, and Ms. Jana Zantovska, Your Excellency Daniel Herman, Czech Minister of Culture, Miluša Horská, Vice President of the Czech Senate, Cardinal Dominic Duka, Archbishop of Prague, leading members of the Roman Catholic, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain, and Zoroastrian communities, distinguished performers, and all gathered here tonight, it is my very great honor to welcome you to this 2014 Templeton Prize Award Ceremony. The virtues of the Templeton Foundation are humility before the limitless wonder of God, expanding the vision of ultimate reality, open-minded inquiry, entrepreneurship of the spirit, and the discipline and adventure of sincere questioning. We'd like to feel that at St. Martin in the Fields, we uphold similar commitments. We endorse your symbol of the Tree of Life as the nourishing, giving, inclusive link between heaven and earth. We are thrilled to host every one of you here, and we invite you into our community of imagination, compassion, and hope. Let's now enjoy Martin Halík as he plays On the Holy Mountain.
Dr. Wells, Dr. Templeton, Monsignor Professor Halík, Ladies and gentlemen, it's my very great pleasure as well as honour to be invited to address you on the occasion of the award of the 2014 Templeton Prize to Monsignor Professor Tomáš Halík, and to thank the John Templeton Foundation for making this possible. I would like to say a few words about the man whose vision has brought us together this evening, namely Sir John Templeton. I had the good fortune to know Sir John well and had many conversations with him on subjects ranging from the global economy, enterprise and investment strategy to history, education and even theology. He was a man who combined an extraordinary breadth of vision, intellectual curiosity and professional competence. Not only that, but he had a generosity of spirit as well as a personal modesty. Although he pioneered financial investment with huge success, his greatest desire was that we might all understand more about our spiritual nature as human beings, something which he summarized as the pursuit of spiritual progress, and which he felt could be furthered through discovery, through research, and through science. And it was because of this that he established the prize that is today being awarded for the 42nd year, the Templeton Prize. John Marks Templeton was born in 1912 in the small town of Winchester, Tennessee. He attended Yale University, supported himself during the Great Depression, graduated in 1934 near the top of the class, was a Rhodes Scholar at Balliol College, Oxford, and graduated from there with a law degree in 1936. He started his career on Wall Street in 1938 and entered the mutual funds industry in 1954. He created some of the world's largest and most successful international investment funds. He employed a strategy of buy low, sell high, but he took it to a new dimension, picking countries, picking industries, and companies which were hitting rock bottom, something he called points of maximum pessimism. However, his interests were never confined simply to the financial world. He devoted the second half of his long life to promoting the discovery of what he called new spiritual information. And in this, he was an unfailing optimist, a believer in progress, and a relentless questioner. The spiritual quest was never limited just to the individual. He insisted that the wider context of the Templeton Prize should always be about the empowerment of the mind and the spirit of others. And for him, this term encompassed progress in understanding not only matters which would usually be considered religious, but also the deepest realities of human nature and the physical world. These, he believed, were best subjects investigated by using the tools of modern science. He was convinced that our knowledge of the universe was still very limited, and his great hope was to encourage all of humanity to be more open-minded about the possible nature of human reality and of the divine. Although Sir John was a Presbyterian, he espoused what he called a humble approach to theology. He believed there's much more to be known about the divine than simply through revelation or present-day theological discussion. Instead, he predicted that the scientific revelations may be a gold mine for revitalizing religion in the 21st century. He once said, "All of nature reveals something of the Creator." And I remember on many occasions listening to him saying that and knowing that for him these were not just words, but something which he believed in deeply. So in 1972, he established the Templeton Prize as one of the world's largest annual awards given to an individual. The prize honors a living person who's made an exceptional contribution to affirming the spiritual dimension of life, whether through personal insight, through scientific discovery, or through practical endeavors. Its monetary value has always exceeded that of the Nobel Prizes, which was Sir John's way of underscoring his view that advances in the spiritual sphere are no less important than those in other areas of human endeavor. In Sir John's words, the prize aims, as we've already heard, to identify entrepreneurs of the spirit. Such persons are outstanding individuals who've devoted their talents to expanding our vision of human purpose and ultimate reality, and to seeking progress in our understanding of the divine. Over the last 40 years, the distinguished roster of Templeton Prize laureates includes representatives of Christianity, of Judaism, Islam, Hinduism, and Buddhism. The prize has been awarded to scientists, philosophers, theologians, members of the clergy, philanthropists, writers, reformers, and for work which has ranged from the creation of new religious orders and social movements to humanistic scholarship and to research regarding the origins of the universe. But what they all have in common is a commitment to exploring the big questions, and he loved that expression, which are at the core of the foundation's mandate. All have sought wisdom, but wisdom humbled by the complexity of the human condition, determined to chart a way forward. Some Templeton Prizes have been given to people who've demonstrated the transformative power of virtues, love, forgiveness, gratitude, creativity. Others have provided new insights into scientific or philosophical problems. Still others have used the analytical tools of the humanity to provide new perspectives on the spiritual dilemmas of modern life. Because of this, you may well have concluded that Sir John's own theological views conform to no orthodoxy, and you would be right to do so. He was eager, as he made it very plain, to learn from all of the world's faith traditions. He said, "What I'm financing through the prize is humility. I want people to realize that you shouldn't think you know it all." These words made a huge impact on me because what I especially noticed about him was that he lived it. Although he was a very wealthy man, he was extraordinarily humble. In this regard, one of Sir John's many great talents was his ability to introduce new ideas and make suggestions without in any way being antagonistic to the person or to the ideas he may have been challenging. Something, I have to say, not common in the academic world of which I was a member. His constant challenging of ideas, always made with an extraordinarily light touch, was never adversarial, but always dialectical in manner. Sir John died in 2008 at the age of 95. Tributes from around the world recognized the breadth of his career and vision, and the extraordinarily generous legacy which he's left to us. The Economist at the time observed that Sir John had revered thrift and had a horror of debt, but he made an exception for love, which he asserted actually needed greater spending. For him, you could give away too much land and too much money, Sir John said, but never enough love. And the real return was immediate. It was more love. Ladies and gentlemen, may I invite you this evening to remember this vision of Sir John Templeton, a man of compassion and unlimited generous love. As we honor Monsignor Professor Tomáš Halík, let us join together, uniting and yet humble-minded in John Templeton's commitment to mind, spirit, and manifest love. Thank you very much.
Now please welcome the Eric Whittaker Singers. My lords, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President and Chairman of the John Templeton Foundation, Dr. John M. Templeton, Jr.
That was a song, which is not my text, that I don't remember or catch any of the words, but I seem to feel quite clearly that this wasn't happiness, this was joy, and the dimensionality, the limitlessness of joy when one only sees it within oneself, but then sees it the way Sir John tried so much to make it a part of not only today, but in every situation. So thank you again. So Reverend Dr. Wells, Sir Giffers, Professor Halleck, ladies and gentlemen, good evening, everyone. On behalf of the trustees and my colleagues at the John Templeton Foundation, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you gathered here in order that today we are so grateful to all of the others who will be watching online as we honor the 2014 Templeton Prize laureate, Monsignor Professor Tomáš Halík. It is a great joy and privilege to hold the Templeton Prize ceremony at St. Martin in the Fields. This is a church whose aim in its life of worship and prayer is not just to provide simple answers, but to uphold one another in, first of all, living with the questions. And then see that questions can increasingly open both our minds and the minds of others, that truths are real, and that in turn, truths can be quite true blessings. Thus, our presence here is so appropriate, since one of the central missions for Sir John in founding the annual Templeton Prize has included exploring questions of such dimensions to more and more lead to breakthroughs in discoveries about spiritual realities. For this privilege, we express our special gratitude to the Reverend Dr. Sam Wells. Reverend Dr. Wells, you, your colleagues, and all of your staff have been so gracious and so helpful in making this celebration an event in which global gratitude is the order of the day. As one of the most notable and remarkable prize winners, Professor Halík is the 44th Templeton Prize laureate since my father, Sir John Templeton, the late global investor, but more so even than what people might call a philanthropist, but somebody who wants to empower every one of you, as we have heard through music and in every other way, to be a blessing to others. So therefore, the basis for this annual prize is a clear perspective of honoring thoroughly remarkable leaders of both limitless spirit and mind, so typically focused on others. As Lord Griffiths noted earlier this year, this evening, Sir John's vision for the prize has always been fostered a pursuit of discovery, most especially the seeking of new insights into the limitless potentials in the realm of the spirit. The essence of this vision is what he summarized as both mental progress and likewise spiritual progress. From the beginning, Sir John envisioned that the prize would identify entrepreneurs of the spirit, those who devote their talents to expanding our vision of the intangible and the deeper realities of human purpose and ultimate reality. If Sir John were still with us today in honoring Professor Halík, he would offer the words he so often emphasized at the Templeton Prize ceremonies. That is, no person may even know 1% of the infinite creative spirit. To learn anything, we must first become humble and rid ourselves of the things that are egotistical, but instead to represent things that we do continue to know about God, but more importantly, to share God with others. The optimal context for this vision is to encourage an open-minded spirit of humility. Many past laureates have typically been characterized not by claims always of finding final answers, but instead by the discipline and the adventure of endless questions. So John stressed that questions, when framed in humility, create an open mind, which in turn makes it possible for us to learn, and especially to learn from each other. Moreover, he saw that from such a passion for learning, a rising level of new glimpses of a larger, timeless truth. In turn, even science itself actually provides wider insights into such glimpses that they become major beneficial contributors to progress. As always, a larger, more projected and optimist, my father foresaw a day when new information from research on spiritual realities might truly reduce conflict between all religions. He felt that from such research, people would come to acknowledge a rich diversity of spiritual information, which is for some universally accessible, or in time could be and may well become those who asked a question on a given day, accessible then to all people. Thus, in this way, it is hoped that all religions will embrace both Sir John's larger spiritual vision and his shaping of our foundation's motto, how little we know, how eager to learn. Therefore, in reflection on President Halík's remarkable life's work, I would like to offer for all of us some quite notable contributions on how he shares my father's vision for spiritual progress. First, he has rigorously pursued intellectual investigations of mind and spirit. Professor Halík asks questions relentlessly and does not seek only simple answers. He has worked tirelessly to explore innovative ways to think about and convey timeless truths to others, so that people of all spiritual and cultural traditions, even atheists, may find new and deeper ways to express them. He and his colleagues were for decades in the underground university and also the underground church in Czechoslovakia. Some of his colleagues are here today with us. And their shared determination was the determination to create the moral and spiritual biosphere, which in his own way of framing how the mind and the spirit can grow and thereby to prepare Czech society for life and freedom. Since that time, he has widely shared his ideas and beliefs worldwide among followers of widely varying cultural and spiritual traditions, and notably also between believers and non-believers. He speaks to those who are believers and non-believers at the same time, much like the man in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verse 24, who cries out, "I believe, help my unbelief." He calls for the church to seek the seekers, and yet he also asks those who seek to have patience with God. For those people who do not believe, even for them, he says that they are also not blind to life's spiritual dimensions, not the least if they were to ask one question, two questions, and beyond. Therefore, that is the basis of being a seeker, which surely begins to open more and more doors. In one of the Big Questions videos, which you can view on our website at the www.templetonprize.org, he challenges us by asking, is God the answer, or rather a question? He states so probingly, answers without questions are like trees without roots. But how often are the Christian truths presented to us like felled, lifeless trees in which birds can no longer find a nest? Professor Halík continues, we must shift from apparently final answers back to infinite questions. Questions are sometimes more important than answers. There are also questions that are so good that it is a pity to spoil them with answers. Today, as we celebrate the Templeton Prize and more than 40 years of the spiritual progress built into the prize, we offer the same homage that Sir John would happily do to Monsignor Professor Halík. He has continually opened vistas that advance human rights and humans' opportunities when they do open their minds and their spirits. Many of his notable and relevant visions correlate in various ways to previous Templeton Prize laureates who have accentuated virtues that are essential to the advancement of society. These virtues include love and the breadth of human qualities such as humility, gratitude, creativity, accelerating creativity, and future-mindedness. For Sir John, each year's prize winner was a blessing because each provided a significant spectrum of wider sense of ways to think, ways that often offered truly transformative ideas. That is the blessing that Professor Halík has brought to us. And by way of this prize, he will offer it to more and more people in the world. You can all learn more about the previous Templeton Prize laureates in an exhibit downstairs here at St. Martin. Those of you watching online can always learn more through our website. In this spirit, we earnestly ask all of you in our global audience to please recognize more specifically, Professor Halík as an inspiration for this ministry. Then, with the diversity and depth of his many contributions, we sincerely hope that among the many here, this evening, in person or via the media, that you may also ponder other persons who in turn will consider other persons in turn as probable, in fact, very, very likely worthy nominees for the 2015 Templeton Prize. In fact, everyone in the world is a potential nominator for the Templeton Prize. I sometimes think that people do not believe me when I say this, but it's true. This is because the very qualities recognized by the prize are wide and also multidimensional concerns or roles, and thus are deeply relevant to every human being in the world. The objectives and criteria for making nominations are clearly provided on the prize website and also in a takeaway brochure at the exhibit downstairs. Thus, in addition to sharing your thoughts with us regarding our honor of the judges, selection of Professor Halík, we also look forward to your range of nominations for the next cycle, which are due July 1 this year. And so again, in the spirit of Sir John and on behalf of the trustees of the John Templeton Foundation and the judges of the Templeton Prize, Professor Halík and Lord Griffiths, please now join me for the presentation of the 2014 Templeton Prize.
This here is the coat of arms of the John Templeton Foundation. And here we have the Lion of Bohemia. Here we have Moravia. And here we have Silesia. And here we have T.H., Tomáš Halík. And down here we have the three people of the Christian Academy of the Czech Republic. And then down here, if you look very carefully, we have a hammer and a sickle. The hammer and the sickle are both broken. And here we have a chain, which is also broken. And here at the bottom, we have the symbol of the Templeton Foundation, which is the Tree of Life.
In that regard, Dad only saw this one or two times before then he could no longer do so, but it is very much around the tree of life. From his viewpoint, however, a tree might have roots that add to solidity and would depend on others, but the great thing about trees or lights are those that keep reaching up and up, which he would see immediately of the things that you've been doing in life when things were not so free, and now that you are much more free, what you are doing to bless so many others. So I would like to put this on.
Thank you.
So there were so many times early in your life when freedom was restricted, and yet really you were not free, but you went past to reach out to those to be able to understand God and a larger vision. That's now much more open, which Dad would consider such a blessing. But I want to share that he already understands, if he could be right here, that your sense of making people free, particularly through the mind, is right even into youngster years. And it was kids 14 to 18 years of life that Dad put his first money in, what they might discover. So perhaps in different ways and in different ideas, this is meant to be an annual way, in particular in your case, of contributing 1.1 million pounds to be able to continue to lift up, to be able to advance some of the still more magic and widespread ideas that you have going forth. So we would like to present this in honor of you. Thank you.
And now, please welcome Laura Mvula and the Eric Whittaker Singers.
Dr. Templeton, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is with joy, respect, humility, gratitude, and above all, an awareness of responsibility and moral commitment that I join the family of Templeton Prize winners this evening. Initially, over 40 years ago, the Templeton Prize was described as an award for progress in religion. At that time, linking the words progress and religion must have sounded odd to many people. Many believers believed there was no need for progress in religion because religion should be a guardian and guarantor of firm order in society. Many non-believers believed that religion was not capable of any progress, that secularism was the final word in the cultural evolution. One generation later, philosopher Inger Habermas declared that we now live in a post-secular world. It is an odd world, however. It contains many unexpected surprises for religious and non-religious people alike. Globally speaking, the phenomenon of religion is not dying, but being transformed. Not only are new religions and religious movements being created, but the old religions are being transformed. and assuming new political and cultural roles. Where traditional religions are suppressed, secular phenomena themselves become a religion. It is small wonder that many representatives of the old religions and the new atheism started to panic. When I first visited Britain almost half a century ago, I arrived from a country whose violently imposed state religion was so-called scientific atheism. Not only was religious freedom totally suppressed in the name of the militant ideology of scientific atheism, but so too was freedom of artistic creation and scientific research. I was happy to be allowed to visit Britain, a country with a long tradition of tolerant Christianity, the wise and cheerful Christianity of Chesterton and C.S. Lewis. Half a century has passed. Buses drive around London with the message, God probably doesn't exist, on their sides. And the statement that Britain is a Christian country gives rise to heated polemic and protest. No, I am not seized by panic. I always find efforts to understand others more congenial than calls for cultural wars. In a certain sense, I'd be more radical than Mr. Dawkins. I'm convinced that a God of Dawkins' atheism, God as a naive scientific hypothesis, doesn't probably not exist. Definitely does not exist. It is not the God of my faith, that's for sure. It is not the God of faith for whose freedom we fought atheism linked to political power. No, it is not religion as such, or science, or even the atheistic interpretation of science that causes difficulties, but instead people with closed minds who think they need to belittle and insult the belief of other people in order to propagate their own. History in our part of the world has shown that atheism is no more immune to the temptation of power than religion. I simply wish that when the new atheism will be older and more adult, it will be at least as tolerant as our old European Christianity of today. But where is our Western Christianity today? What forms does it take? And what is its vision for the future? I am not surprised by the statements such as Britain is a Christian country or Europe is a Christian continent should cause a storm. On the one hand, there are numbers of historical and sociological arguments in support of them. After all, the secular character of society is itself an offspring of Christianity. And in certain sense, even the European atheism is a Christian phenomenon. On the other hand, statements such as Britain is a Christian country or Europe is a Christian continent are bound to provoke the question, what do you mean by them? And what conclusions do you draw from them? What form of Christianity could help our world to be a better place for the lives of all, both Christians and non-Christians, both believers and atheists? We have witnessed it how the power of religious symbols can become a destructive force and source of violence when linked to political interests. Now, it's necessary to ask, how can the power of faith be used to create a culture of mutual respect, a civilization in which difference will not be perceived as a threat, but a scope for mutual enrichment? What progress should occur in religion in order for us to enjoy a culture of sharing in place of the fear of clash of civilizations? What can religions, and specifically Christianity, do to transform the globalization process into a culture of communication? At the time of my first visit to Britain, in the summer of 1968, Russian tanks in my country crashed the Prague Spring slender hopes of at least a bit of freedom and democracy. My second visit to Britain was possible only after the fall of the gigantic Soviet Empire that was ruled by the combination of old-style Russian imperialism and the ideology of scientific atheism. Today, not only the countries of Central and Eastern Europe are watching with great concern the attempts of the Kremlin rulers to resurrect the old empire. The ideology of scientific atheism died a long time ago in Russia. But old-style Russian nationalism and imperialism dreams are still very much alive. During World War II, Stalin, one of the cruelest persecutors of religion in human history, realized that the Russian people were not prepared to die for the communist ideology of scientific atheism, and he tried to use the Orthodox religion and Russian patriotism to save his empire. We now have the spectacle of former KGB agents kissing the icons of Christ and Mother of God. Will the leaders of the Russian Orthodox Church have the moral courage of the biblical prophets to tell the present Kremlin rulers, you must first drive from your heads and hearts the demons of Dostoevsky's possessed before bringing your sacrificial gifts to the house of the Lord? In the light of the dangerous developments in Eastern Europe, we must be aware of our responsibility for preserving and enhancing the great project of a united Europe. The strong political integration of Europe is the only protection for the European nations, not only against external dangers, but even more so against an explosion of barbarism within, against the extreme nationalism, chauvinism, and xenophobia that are once more raising their ugly heads in the countries of Europe. If the danger and temptation of national selfishness and isolationism were to triumph in Europe, leading to the tragic collapse of the European Union, the nation states of Europe would not acquire greater sovereignty, but instead would be exposed far more to the forces of chaos and destruction from within. If the common European home is to be a real home, it cannot be based solely on administration and trade. Culture has a decisive role to play in the creation, the spirit spiritual and moral biosphere of society. The communist system, in which culture was controlled by ideology, was unable to survive in the free global market of ideas. But what will happen to a society whose culture has lost its spiritual dimension and instead dominated by the commercial entertainment industry? A crucial role in the emergence of Europe was played by the church's ability to create a culture that combined the message of the Bible with philosophical wisdom of Greece and the legal system of Rome. But that form of Christianity, Christianitas, Christendom, now belongs to the past. Christianity is no longer the common language of Europeans. The Europe of the future will be an even richer polyphony than it has been so far. Christianity today is only one of many voices. Let us not ask whose voice will be stronger in the Europe tomorrow, but instead, whose will contribute more to a culture of coexistence based on mutual respect and understanding. Christianity's center message is that God is love, and the triune God is itself a community of sharing. Belief in a God who is love and community of sharing is not a scientific hypothesis, but a moral commitment with obvious cultural and political implications. It is a commitment to accept the plurality of our world and to strive constantly to transform it into a culture of communication, sharing, and mutual enrichment. Christianity does not need to be a flag flying over Europe. But Europe and the world needs people who restore the word love the profound meaning that it had in the radical message of the gospel. Our Western Christian culture and its important historical phase of enlightenment gave rise to the great idea of tolerance. Tolerance is a secular translation of the gospel injunction of love to one's enemies. But when religious concepts are translated into secular language, something is usually lost. In order to tolerate an unpleasant neighbor, I really don't need to love him in any sense. It is enough for me to ignore him, since I don't care about him. We each have our own life, our own style, our own truths. A certain model of multiculturalism, based on principle of toleration, resulted not in a community of citizens, of neighbors, but in a conglomeration of ghettos. Let everyone live as they like, so long as they don't disturb and restrict others. This is certainly a more humane situation than the constant quarrels or even permanent warfare. But can it be a lasting solution? That sort of tolerance is fine for people living alongside each other, but not people living together. The trouble is that our world, the global village, has become too cramped for us to live undisturbed like that alongside each other.
Our numbers have grown, and whether we like it or not, there are more and more people who are different from us. Our fences are not as far apart as they used to be. We can see into the kitchens and smell the aromas of exotic soups from the dining rooms of those others. We can't ignore family rows of which we had no inkling before. The tolerance model was created for a different world, for a different city architecture. But those cities of yore are no longer standing, or they look completely different from the way they used to. We live together, whether we like it or not, and therefore we must find different rules for this coexistence that simply keep out of my circle. But our circles have already been violated. Such close proximity often leads to conflict. One cannot back away in the face of violence. It is necessary to protect and defend the innocent. One must turn only one's own cheek if there is hope of hurting evil thereby, but not the cheek of the others. Those we must defend. We have responsibility for them. But we can and must do everything to stop things getting to that point. In the many threatened places, there are still time for prevention and treatment of violence, time for dialogue. Interreligious dialogue usually takes the form of conferences, opportunities for well-educated representatives of various religions to meet. Such meetings can definitely serve as an important signal, but they have one weakness. Little by little, they create a subculture of dialogists who soon understand each other much better than they do the extremists in their respective communities. Most people prefer to associate with those who listen to them and accept them. But is it not the duty of those who take part in such meetings to ask themselves how much scope and courage they have to influence those within their own communities who perceive believers of other religions with a mixture of prejudice, fear, and hatred? And it is not one of the fundamental duties of religious leaders to have the prophetic courage to protest against the misuse of religion in the service of power and to take a stand against all those who commit injustice and violence against the innocent? 2,000 years ago, the rabbi from Nazareth was asked, "Who is my neighbor?" That question has lost none of its urgency in the meantime. Jesus turned the question around in an astonishing way. Don't ask, "Who is your neighbor?" Become neighbor yourself. Be close to others, particularly those who need help and love. Offer freedom to those who languish in the prison of their own hatred and guilt by showing forgiveness and readiness for reconciliation. Jesus' call for unconditional love. Love even for one's enemies seems absurd chiefly to those who regard love as a sentiment, as an emotion. But love is something greater than that. It is a space of security in our hearts and lives that we offer to others to let them truly be themselves. Only in a space of love and acceptance can we discover the truths about ourselves. Can we develop the best that is within us? But love is always a bold and risky step. Whoever loves risks being disappointed and wounded. Only at this point may I answer the question about the future of faith. I believe in a faith that bears wounds. Crucial to my Christian faith is one particular scene in John's Gospel. The encounter between the Apostle Thomas and the resurrected Christ. Within Thomas's heart, as in the hearts and minds of many people today, faith and doubt are in conflict. Only when Jesus shows him his wounds does Thomas cry out, "My Lord and my God." Our world is full of wounds. It is my conviction that those who close their eyes to the wounds in our world have no right to say, "My Lord and my God." A religion that ignores people's misfortune and suffering is an opium of the people. A God that does not bear wounds is a dead God. When someone offers me their God, I ask, it is the God of love, wounded by our world suffering. I am not willing to believe in any other God. I recently read the spiritual diary of Mother Teresa of Calcutta, the first Templeton Prize winner. I had previously known how she filled her days, namely, with the service to the poorest, the sick, and the dying. Now I know what her nights were like. She endured the grim trials of religious doubt, the dark nights of the spirit, the experience of God's silence. She bore the cross of dual solidarity. In the daytime, she was sister to those who needed their bodily wounds healed and the hunger of their empty stomachs assuaged. At night, she shares the darkness of those who feel themselves far from the light of God and suffer emptiness of the soul. Yes, therein lies true progress in religion. It is the courage to combine spiritual depth with the open embrace of solidarity with all those who suffer. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, another Templeton Prize winner, once answered the question, what would follow communism? Very, very long period of healing. My answer to the question, what will come after the period when many believers and non-believers thought It was so easy to talk about God. I expect a very, very long journey in the depth. And I've pinned my hopes on it. Thank you.
I invite you to remain standing for the benediction. May God give us a tongue to speak the truth and a thirst slaked only by justice. May God give us ears to hear the world's pain and patience to listen to advice. May God give us eyes to see beauty where many might miss it and perception to see reality from another person's point of view. May God give us a nose to sniff out what's wrong and a longing to put it right. May God give us hands to receive the most precious things life has to give and to cherish them for all their worth. May we see God's face and be surrounded with God's love today and every day. Show us the way, Lord God, and meet us down by the river and dress us with robe and crown every time we pray. Amen.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and studying about that good old way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, down, down. Down the river to pray. As I
sister.